in all these cases that we saw here, the system tends to become less stable. Okay, I'm losing this in a very loose sense. System is either stable or not stable. What do you understand when I say less stable? The poles are moving towards the geometry axis. The system tends to become less stable when A naught F increases or decreases? When A naught F increases. So now, based on this idea, can you tell me which of these amplifiers is more stable? So this is R, this is R. Which is more stable? F is half here, whereas F is 1 here. So you will be, the closed loop gain will be 2. But this is more stable, this is less stable. And I put this in quotes because I mean you understand what I'm saying. So if you had an op amp which has, you know, some poles and zeros inside and it's being compensated to make sure that the closed loop is stable. The worst case for stability occurs when the closed loop gain is the op amp is basically a generic building block which anybody can buy and realize a closed loop gain of whatever you want by putting in an appropriate ratio of external resistors. Correct? If I was making an op amp, I should make sure that it will work for you and you and you and you and you and you and everybody else. But a priori, I don't know what gain you want. What should I do to compensate the op amp? What F should I assume? As we just discussed, stability becomes more of an issue when you want a higher closed loop gain or a lower closed loop gain. Stability becomes more of an issue when you want a lower closed loop gain. So you would design the compensating network inside the operational amplifier such that stability is achieved for the lowest possible gain that anybody might hook the op amp to do. And what is the lowest gain that one might want to realize using an op amp? The manufacturer assumes that the lowest gain you want is unity, so the op amp will be compensated for the lowest gain expected to be realized by the user, and this is assumed to be the closed loop gain is 1 is sorry, closed loop gain which is equal to 1 over F is happens to be 1, and this, I mean this is often termed the op amp is compensated for unity gain. When somebody says the op amp is compensated for unity gain, it means that when you put this op amp as a forward amplifier in a closed loop system where the closed loop gain is unity, then the op amp is guaranteed to be stable. Does it make sense? If you want to realize an unstable system, you want to make the loop unstable, what would you do? Make F larger than 1. If you took an op amp which is guaranteed to be stable for unity gain, and between these two if I put another amplifier and if I hook this back this way, I will always be able to find an amplifier where the gain is enough to make the system oscillate. Because A naught F is going on increasing, it's only a matter of time before the F becomes so large that, you know, the system will oscillate. You understand? And why is it called internal compensation? It's called internal compensation simply because the compensating network or whatever is needed to make this dominant pole is inside the op-amp chip. So the user doesn't have to bother with designing the compensating network himself or herself. You just pick and then that it is definitely compensated for unity gain. A couple of simple approximations for an op-amp. So the op-amp gain is of the form some ADC, the DC gain, divided by 1 plus S by omega D. So this is the dominant pole, and you have a whole bunch of higher order poles, omega P1, and so on. And the manufacturers made sure that omega D is sufficiently small so that the op-amp is unity gain stable. So common approximation for this is to approximate the gain of the op-amp for quick calculation to be of the form ADC divided by 1 plus S by omega D. So in other words, it really, you think of it as just simply the first order system, alright, with a pole at omega D. And so if I plot log of the gain of the op-amp, the magnitude log omega, the approximation basically as ADC at low frequencies, and then it falls off with the slope of unity, and this is log of omega D, alright, where this is 0. When the log of A of j omega is 0, it means that the magnitude of the gain is 1. So the question now is, what is this frequency? This frequency is that at which the magnitude becomes unity, which is approximately 0. Omega D times ADC. Is that clear? So this is omega D times ADC. Can somebody tell me what this is called? This is the product of the DC gain and the 3 dB bandwidth of the amplifier. So this is called the gain bandwidth product. Of the operational does it make sense? The DC gain will typically be 10^5, 10^6. So the dominant pole of the op amp will be, if the gain bandwidth product is about a megahertz, then so FD, the dominant pole in hertz, is simply the gain bandwidth product in megahertz divided by the DC gain. The DC gain is about 10^6 for 741. So the dominant pole is about a hertz. You understand? The basic idea is to be able to push dominant pole so low that the op amp characteristic pretty much looks like a first order system. You understand? So at the circuit level, you have seen, for example, that the simplest op amp that we designed was of this form. So let's see what we can do to implement which is the positive input of the op-amp and which is the negative input of the op-amp. So this is VCC and this is VEE, which I'll assume to be negative, so that input common mode voltage of 0 lies within the common mode range of the differential pair. So which is the positive terminal, A or B? How will you figure it out? I will assume some random signs, say plus and minus, and see what happens. I just have to go from input to output and make sure that the gain is, assume A to be positive. Let's see what happens. If A is positive, V out should go up when I yank A up. If I yank A up, what happens to this node? What happens to this guy? Does this potential go up or go down? Up. This goes up. If this goes up, what happens to the collector? It goes down. If this goes down, what happens to the emitter? Goes down. So if I increase A, V out is going down. So is my original assumption correct or wrong? It's wrong. So A is the inverting terminal of the op amp. And B is, this is the non-inverting terminal. Do you understand? We've already discussed frequency response of stages and so on. This is a common emitter amplifier. There will be how many poles? We replace the transistor by its high frequency incremental circuit and blah blah blah, go through all that, I did all that. There are only two nodes in a common emitter amplifier, so how many poles can it have? It has got two poles and how many zeros? 1, 0. And we also discussed that the zero frequency is much higher than the pole frequency, so we can kind of neglect the zero for the time being. So this amplifier will have two poles. What about this chap here? Assume perfectly differential excitation. If this goes up, this goes down. So this incrementally is grounded. So what is the, this behaves like a, what kind of amplifier? Common emitter. So that is two more poles, but then this node is common to both the second amplifier and the first amplifier. So there are actually only, there is one pole here, there is another pole here, And what did we see as far as the bandwidth of the common collect amplifier is concerned? Without even thinking, you can tell me. What is the gain of the common collect amplifier? Incremental gain? 1. So, you can expect that the bandwidth will be much larger than what you got for a common emitter amplifier, because in the common emitter amplifier the, you know, the gain is very large. You understand? The bandwidth of the common collector amplifier is very high. So, and there are two poles. When I say the bandwidth of the common collect amplifier is very high, it basically means that the pole due to the common collect amplifier is very, very high in frequency when compared to the poles at this node and this. So, virtually, this looks like a what order system? There are three poles, but one pole is very, very far away from the other two. So, it basically looks like a second order system. Okay, so there is one pole at this point and another pole at this node. And we saw the expression for DC gain, and I am not going to go through it again. The gain of the op amp is of the form now, 1 plus S by omega P1, 1 plus S by omega P2. Alright, the P1 is coming because of this node and the P2 is coming because of that node. The pole at that. Is that clear? If I want to make this look like a first order system, I need to add a dominant pole. Right? I need to somehow introduce, I need something of the form ADC divided by 1 plus S by omega D times something else. One way of doing it is to add an explicit dominant pole, or in other words, to cascade the op amp with a separate network whose transfer function is 1 divided by 1 plus S by omega D. Is there a smarter way of doing it? You know, one clever idea is to say, hey, you know, why bother with introducing a new pole? If I made, say, omega P1 very, very small, then I am done. You understand? It's all, please note that it's always very easy to make a pole very, very low. It's only difficult to make things faster. It's very easy to make things slow. Correct? So, to introduce a dominant pole, the strategy make omega P1 say much, much smaller than omega P2. Right? So, how would you accomplish that? If you want to make omega P1 very, very small compared to omega P2, in other words, I had to make the pole at node, at this node for example, much lower in frequency than it now is. So what determines any pole frequency must be of the form some 1 over some r times some c. Okay. So can you suggest a way in which I can make the pole at this one pole much, much lower? No, these are already, the output, the resistance at this node is the output impedance of the PNP transistor, parallel the output impedance of the NPN transistor. Okay? So what is the easiest thing you can think of that can make, this is some R, this is C. And you know, there's some current feeding into this node. So the output voltage is the input current I times R divided by 1 plus SCR. The pole frequency is at 1 over RC. If I want to bring the pole frequency low, what should I do? Either increase R or reduce C, or I could do both. If I change R, what would happen? The gain will also change. So if I want to keep the gain the same, but if I want to just change the pole, what should I do? I should change the capacitor. If I have to make omega P very, very low, then 1 over RC must become small, which means C must increase. And please note that a low frequency pole is like saying the node has got a lot of excess baggage, a lot of inertia there, which means it's very difficult to make the voltage at that node move, which will mean that there is a big fat capacitance sitting at that node. Simplest thing one can think of, which is obvious right away, is the following, is to add a capacitance C here, let me call that CC. C sub C stands for compensating capacitance. You understand? If I wanted to make omega P1, maybe omega P2 divided by say 10 power 5, just for argument's sake, example, then what should I do? Omega P2 approximately the resistance at this node, which is the output impedance, is this PMOS transistor, parallel the output impedance is this current source, times the parasitic capacitance at this node. So if I wanted to make omega P1 10 power 5 times smaller, then what should be the value of CC approximately? Okay, so what is omega P1? Approximately equal to, assume the betas of all the transistors are infinite and Q3 and Q2 have some output resistance R0. So what is omega P1 approximately? It is 2 by R0, see, because the output impedance of Q3 and Q2 are both R0, so the equivalent resistance of that node is R0 by 2. So omega P1 is approximately 2 by R0 times CC. Similarly, omega P2 is approximately 1 over R0 times, denote the parasitic capacitance at this node by Cx. That comes about because of device parasitics in Q4 and Q5. So this is about 1 over R0 Cx. If you now want omega P1 to be 10 power 5 times smaller than omega P2, what does that mean? Cc must be approximately 2 Cx times 10 power 5. Is that fine? All that I am saying is that the capacitance CC is a large one. So it is 5 orders of magnitude larger than CX. So for example, if CX is of several tens of femtofarads, which are normal ranges of capacitances for devices on IC, then CX will be of the order of the tens of femtofarads multiplied by 10 power 5 is about a nanofarad. And a nanofarad is a very, very large amount of capacitance on an IC. several tens of picofarads are alright, but a nanofarad will basically mean that the capacitance will occupy so much space on the chip that the economics of integrated circuit fabrication become unviable. If all your chip is some dumb capacitor, right, it's such a waste of space. For typical ranges involved, the amount of CC that you need to put in here becomes inordinately large to make economic sense. But if you put a small CC, then the compensation is not effective enough. Is that clear? So, what do you think I can do? Then one could argue, hey, I tried to make omega P1 smaller compared to omega P2. What if I tried the opposite? So instead of putting CC here, I will try and put CC here. But a little thought will show that it's the devil or the deep sea, right? Both of them are just as bad, okay? So the order of magnitude of CC required for effective compensation still remains the same. And then some smart guy comes around and says, hey, so I need a large capacitance between these two nodes. And in the last class, what did we see? We said that it is possible to electronically multiply capacitance. So, if I wanted a large capacitance, all I need is take a large high gain amplifier of gain A, or minus A, and put a capacitance of C1 here. If I did this, then the equivalent capacitance looking in here is? It's 1 plus A times C1, which is approximately A times C1 if A is much, much larger than 1. So, what should I do now? So, if A is say 10 power 3 or 10 power 2, then what was nanofarads before can now only become tens of picofarads, so it's 100 times smaller. So, what should I do now? I have now found a way of making a large capacitance from a small capacitance. So where should I hook this up? Between Q3 and Q4. So then I say, hey, this seems like a smart idea. Omega P1, which was earlier of the order of 2 by R0 times CC, is now of the order of 2 divided by R0 times A plus 1 times C1. I now need a much smaller C1. So thanks to this, I can now use a much smaller compensating capacitance than I would have needed before. And some of the smart guy comes along and says, hey, this is stupid. I can do something smarter. What is that? Please note that this is an inverting amplifier. So in other words, if I yank this up, this goes down. But you already have an inverting amplifier somewhere. Where is that? Q4. Because if this incrementally increases, this decreases. So you don't need this extra amplifier after all. What you could do is you just hook the capacitor across this represents a complete op-amp which has a chance of working. The swings are taken care of, the gain is high enough and it is compensated so that it works for purity gain. This is this. You have two stages and you have a compensating capacitor in this fashion, and this kind of compensation, because it exploits the Miller effect, is called Miller compensation. also equivalent to dominant pole compensation. If I now replace every NPN transistor here with an NMOS transistor and a PNP transistor by a PMOS transistor, it will give you a CMOS op-amp. Now you could turn this whole schematic upside down, replace every NPN transistor with a PNP transistor and vice versa, replace VCC with VEE and vice versa, and you will have another schematic where the input differential pair is now a PNP differential pair rather than an NPN one. So that finishes the discussion on feedback, frequency compensation and stabilizing a negative feedback loop.